Yeah,
hold
there's
on one
yeah,
second.
yeah,
Hold on
yeah,
one second.
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Hold on one second. You went to West Point?
Yeah.
That
So,
was your college?
yeah, that was my college. Yeah, so.
I thought you just went to the military. I didn't know you went
No,
to.
second lieutenant.
Oh my gosh.
Hey,
Yeah, so.
just so you know, Mark, I read your resume. Okay. I know
Okay.
you went to West Point, man. I thought we were gonna wait a little bit to talk about all that shit, but
We will, we will,
Yeah,
we will, we will,
I
we will,
think I
we
think
will.
why don't we Hey, let's go.
All right, guys, welcome to the Outloud podcast sponsored by On the Path. Today we have the amazing, the powerful, the incredible, the brilliant Marc Ortiz. He's going to chop it up today with us a little bit about West Point, a little bit about the stock market and living on Wall Street and what that was all about, a little bit about India and the beautiful babies over there, a little bit about GameStop. Yeah, GameStop. We need to know about that. What's going on with that? A little bit about what's going to happen in the world according to him, and maybe a little Burning Man. So let's give it up. Out loud welcome for Marc Ortiz.
Why don't we start there, man? Talk a little bit about coming out of high school and what was going on with you that you applied and got into West Point and got your congressional, stuff and
Yeah,
did.
yeah,
It's a
the
pretty neat
appointment, all
process.
that. All right, so military service. I wanted to be a pilot. I was like the generation that watched Top Gun, right? And then I was always into like space and just the SR-71, spy airplane, and that's literally what I wanted to do. Like grade school, like seven. That's what I wanted to do. And then I think like my freshman year or something, my eyes just went to shit, right? And at that time, you couldn't. There's I think they had the LASIK barely just emerging, right? But the rules were like, you got this, like it automatically disqualified you, right?
Oh my
And
God.
so then, so, looking at Air Force Academy, Naval Academy, he's like, whoa, well, let me check out, oh, West Point, what's this all about? And I'm like, oh, hey, this is, oh, wow, there's like some pretty cool stuff here. And, I think General Schwarzkopf, I think at the time, you got Desert Storm and all these things going on. And I think those were the initial inspirations. And that's
So
what
that
just,
didn't deter you though, right? Being like on the verge of war and all that stuff, like that didn't deter you. You're in. You're gonna be a military guy from a long time.
oh yeah, that's right. That's right. I think, and it's, you think about it in hindsight, right? You think to yourself, like, man, it was like Desert Storm was almost like the first, at least from my understanding, it was the first war like on TV, right? Like people were watching like, the green sort of like rounds getting flown up and getting shot up in the air in
I
Baghdad.
remember all
Like,
the
hey,
tracers.
yeah, the tracers, right? Yeah, the tracers, and then the whole what 100 hour war and whatnot. It was quick and fast, and so in your mind you're thinking, oh wow, this is war is pretty quick, clean, and we get in and out, and that's the way it is. And interesting how that changed. I think over the reality is obviously nowhere near what's depicted on TV. So that did not deter me at all. So.
Wow, that's cool.
What was your studies? What did you go in and study then? Whenever you got
Okay,
into the
so
job.
when I went to West Point, I was a math major and a computer science minor. Thought about doing economics, which I guess sort of ties into what I ended up doing after the Army. But just for some reason, you know what? I just felt, let's go do pure math, science type stuff. And I'm kind of a dork nerd, I guess. And
That's so
yeah, that's just
awesome,
kind of what I
man.
did. So.
Everybody has to have an engineering minor though, or something, right? When they go to West Point,
Oh,
like,
that's correct. Yes. So, like, my roommate was a Spanish major, right? But he took like computer science classes or whatnot, and so everyone's got to do some sort of engineering.
I have an athlete there. I have a softball player that's at West Point in her second year
Oh.
now.
Oh. Okay. Oh,
And
wow.
I don't know what it's like with COVID, but she's a hell
Oh,
of
yeah.
a human being,
That's a good question. I don't know. Yeah. I don't know how they're handling it. I did. A buddy of mine did send me a. I guess the beast photo, and they got like these plastic barriers, and the upperclassmen's yelling at them, but there's like plastic like screens, literally. Yeah, so I'm like, okay, that's interesting, but
like a salad bar.
yeah,
Did you get
exactly.
any good advice going in? Was there anybody that you can go, yeah, they gave me the right advice, or was it kind of sketchy?
It was sketchy.
Yeah.
you know, I think, my parents grew up in East LA, and I grew up in Whittier, or Pico Rivera, moved to Whittier. And at the time, no one went to West Point, no one knew Naval Academy. I don't think anyone knew Air Force. Right. And I didn't know anything. I think there was one book that I read that I'm like, okay, I have a general idea of what's going to happen, but overall, it was just a little shock and awe when you first get there. So,
I mean, were you pretty confident? I mean, you did you feel like you belonged there, and it was just a matter of getting through all the traditions and stuff, or did you like, oh shit, I don't know what I got into here?
You know, I think I felt out of place. I will say that, and I think it's more Latino. There weren't that many Latinx, right? The cadets there. It was few and far between, and so that I think was a little different, right? So totally different backgrounds. I think a lot of people came from very upper middle class suburban areas, and that was just sort of like, it was just different. And so I would say, I think for me though, that I wanted to prove that I could be there, and so that was sort of my motivation. And don't get me wrong, there's times, I think my last like sophomore year, it's like that's the last time you could really quit, and I was pretty it was close. And it was some family members talked to me and said, you better stick this out, et cetera, et cetera. And so I stuck it out. So,
Mark, what was going on? What was going on at that time? What was the, just had enough?
Oh, geez. So that was, that was around 97. I think you had all this, this whole tech thing going on too, right? Silicon Valley, right? So that was like the 99, 2000, you have all the stuff. And you're kind of reading these business magazines, like, man, I could be going to these schools, like any computer science and Silicon Valley. That was like when that was coming up, right? Yeah, like
the grass is greener.
Yeah, exactly, right? And you just hear about these guys making all this money, like, man, I'm in this like prison, and like, what's going on here? Like, you just see these, that really was like the start of, the I guess .com boom, if you will, though, initially. But then you have .com crash in like 99, 2000, right?
Yeah.
I think that was, you just start seeing that the other grass is greener, and it really is like a prison there. It's tough. So I think your junior year, you could finally leave like two weekends out of the semester, and then your first year, which is your senior year, you could leave campus for like the weekend, and even then you get like certain number of weekend passes. So it's a grind. It was a 4-year grind, and I'd say one of the happiest days was me graduating, just like I'm out of this place. So.
Rick Cepeda, Coach Cepeda over at St. Paul, Rick. His brother was just an enlisted man, and just kind of worked he's a year younger than us, and he just kind of worked his way through, and he veered off into the medical path, which opened up a ton of doors for him in the military. So he was a 20-year military guy. And he spent 4 years at West Point doing his MOS, in the medical side. Mm-hmm. And on the fourth year he was there, he called up Rick and said, yeah, you guys need to come out for the Army Navy game. I mean, this is my last shot. I'm not going to be here next year. Mm-hmm. Come to West Point, fly into New York, drive up. Let's check out the whole thing. And then we'll drive down to Philly for the game and watch the game. And we were all kind of like, really, 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 let's go. And what had happened was, by the time we got to West Point, everybody had made their way down to the game on the buses and the shuttles and all that stuff.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The place was a ghost town.
It's a ghost town, yep.
And this dude is just like a homeboy from Whittier, man. And he was like, all right, come on, let's go. I'm going to take you. And we went places that were top secret, double.
Oh, nice. I mean, yeah.
We were in the
probably went to the mess hall, right?
The place that I remember was, he took us into there was like a bar or a saloon just for officers.
Okay.
And on the wall, Chuck, was a painting, but it was a historical account, like a timeline on it was bitching.
Wow.
I'm talking wood, I'm talking leather, drink and bourbon.
Yeah. Oh,
man,
he probably took you to the first E Club, which
I knew that we weren't supposed to be there, but I was like, all right.
no, that's a good place. And you happen to go to I think the most impressive part is like the mess hall where they feed everyone, and so it's just they the feed 4,000 exactly. It's 4,000 cadets all at once. You eat in 20 minutes. It's impressive, right?
Wow.
And just the scale, and it's pretty impressive. So that's pretty.
We didn't get to see anybody eat, but we got to see this. We got to walk inside. He said the same thing. He was like, "You never see anything like this, man."
he's absolutely right.
Knowing what I know about just the traditions that, you know, that going to high school offered us, because it's different. I coached for a long time at a lot of different schools, and it's different, you know. So when you're indoctrinated with all that tradition, and, you know, you go with certain places and you're on a schedule and you're singing songs and you know, believe in all that stuff, it's a really neat thing now that I'm old enough
to absolutely
look back and go, wow, I'm glad I had that in my life, because the people that don't are missing something. So getting to getting to West Point, that just must be like on steroids, man.
That's next level.
Yeah.
What a great experience.
It really is. And I think, you know, one of the things that people are shocked to hear sometimes is that I think there's not more than 50,000 actual graduates ever from West Point, right? And you think of like some place like University of Texas that has like 50,000 people at once, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And so that's awesome. That's one thing, I think I sometimes like forget. It's like, wow, like, you know, there's my classmate out there that, you know, I haven't talked to in 6 years. I'm like, hey buddy, I'm in Seattle. And you know, it was literally just like old times. And yeah. I think there's definitely a bond there, especially if we got to like with my old roommate. You know, we were in Iraq, you know, we were in Baghdad, and you know, just cool to see him 6 years later. And he gives me, I thought it was kind of funny. He said, hey man, you left this at my house 6 years ago. Here you go, this jacket. But it's just an amazing bond, if you will. And
Now, are you in more contact with the military guys or more contact with the St. Paul guys? Would you say?
I would say the military. Definitely the military people. Like just
that was your adulthood, and
my adulthood and whatnot. And I feel like I have different stages. I feel like of my life, or chapters, if you will. I think, I mean, we all do, right? And so I think there's like the military. There's like my finance side, and now there's this weird Burning Man, I guess, chapter. So.
I can't wait to get to all that stuff. let me ask you another question, though. It's what point, like, you almost wanted to go home after your sophomore year, in your sophomore year somewhere, you know, you thought about that, it was getting to be, was there the moment when it clicked in where you went, nah, I got this, you know, this is something I can do, or was it just a grind all the way through?
No, I think it was a second semester, sophomore year, you know, and excuse me. I think I'd have to say it was a lot with my roommate, you know, his name's Rob Barnes, and who I mentioned, you know, we were in Baghdad together, and we both were sort of like, he was from Vegas, you know, I'm from LA, and we both kind of came up like from nothing, and we're like, you know what, man, no, we got to do this. We can't quit. We can't let these guys beat us down. And so that was our attitude.
Let me ask you another question, though. It's what point, like, you almost wanted to go home after your sophomore year, in your sophomore year somewhere, you know, you thought about that, it was getting to be, was there the moment when it clicked in where you went, nah, I got this, you know, this is something I can do, or was it just a grind all the way through?
No, I think that was a second semester, sophomore year. So your sophomore year, your class, you're in a company, right? You get scrambled all over to different companies. They do that for certain reasons, so that, you know, they had the cheating scandals, etc., in the 70s and whatnot. And interesting enough, that same roommate, we got to the same company again. So we were in the same company for 4 years, which is very rare. Mm-hmm. And so that kind of just like solidifies that sort of a bond friendship that we have.
When I think of St. Paul, so I was a public school kid when I went to St. Paul. I didn't go to Catholic school. And when I went there, I was really, really punched in the face with the concept of hazing. I never experienced hazing before. And we got it pretty good. You know, that was the 80s, the early 80s. And it was pretty good. There's a lot of good stories. But what was it like? What was your behavior as a senior at St. Paul versus your hazing technique when you were a senior at West Point? Was there any,
that's a good question.
Did you chill out more? Was it a different kind of thing? Was it the same thing? Because I know at St. Paul, it's almost a peer pressure thing that you got to participate, but I don't know if that's the same way at West Point.
I would say it's a little bit different. I think it's more of a mental game, right? Okay. It's they want to see how much they can stretch you without, from a mental perspective versus like a physical perspective.
My youngest son went into the military. He went into the army and he was a medic and he did very well. And I didn't know how he was going to handle it, you know, like meeting the other people across people from all over the country in different places, different accents. And I asked him, and he was very, very successful with what he was doing. It was super proud dad moment. It certainly had nothing to do with me.
Oh yeah.
But I asked him one time, I said, why are you succeeding in your mind? So I can pass it on to players and athletes and kids in my class. And he goes, you know, Dad, I just respect that the military is a science, and I know that they've already thought it out. Oh, yeah. And whatever they say is gospel. And I don't, there's no point for me to question it. Number one, it's above my rank. Number two, they've already thought about it for a couple hundred years. And I really, and so he would just release himself to the process, you know, whereas a guy like me would be like, shit, man, why are we doing this, man? Why are we doing this? What the hell? You know, like he was not, he was like, okay, yeah, you want me to stand on my head? Okay, cool. You know, like he never wasted any energy with that. And I wonder how your experience was. Was there times where you were kind of bent out of shape about things, or did they explain things to you very well?
No, that's a very good question. And he's right. There's like this whole like military decision-making process, right? And
you said there's a manual for everything.
There really is. Yeah, no, there's a manual for everything. I think when you're doing these exercises, you go through, get the map, the sand table, where, okay, you're going to do this at this time, and rehearsals, et cetera. At the time you think, man, why go through this over and over again? But it makes, when you actually get to the actual operation, when things go wrong, and they will, you're able to react because you have a plan in place already, and you probably have a secondary plan, and you probably got plan C as well. I think we'll kind of get into my frustrations, I guess, and maybe we'll talk about it here, is, you know, I felt that in Iraq, we could beat anyone like toe to toe, like tactically, like no questions asked, right? Like we're superior. We had superior equipment, training, people, et cetera, right? And that's where I think where we excelled in the Army, Marines, Navy, et cetera. I think when it came to the strategic level of like, how do you rebuild this country? That's where it just fell apart, in my opinion. I think a lot of people have, there's books written about it, right? Or just how from a strategic country building perspective, it just went awry, right? But I think from as your son said, we got it down, we're pros, and no one's going to, you know, basically no one's going to kick our ass when you go toe to toe. And that's definitely true from my experience. So
when we think about Vietnam movies, and stuff, there was so much more autonomy for the platoon leaders. And, you know, if we have to make a call, we're making a call, and we're going. It doesn't sound like that was your experience in Iraq. It sounded like there was a lot of oversight.
There's a lot of oversight, but, you know, our platoon leaders had autonomy, I would say. If you got to make a decision, you got to make a decision. There's no calling up, right? If if rounds are coming in, right? So, I would say Vietnam. I feel just like I watch some of the movies, and you're just like, man, I don't know if I could have done that. You know, just I look at some of these movies.
Well, the other question is in Vietnam era, the West Point guys were looked down upon by the everyday guys. Correct. Did you get any pushback on being a cadet?
No, actually, that's surprisingly no. Most of the guys I worked with, actually, or like my platoon, the guys I led, they actually were always surprised that I went to West Point, though. So I always take that as a compliment. They're like, wait, sir, you went to West Point? Oh, yeah. I'm like, what? Oh, I thought you were like,
you went there?
Yeah, enlisted. And like, so I don't know if that's good or bad, but I think it was a compliment because they could see me as like one of them. And
I think that's a great expression of their, you know, your leadership to them, you know, that to be able to say that and feel that about you, you know, I mean, that's a great
compliment. Can I get you to elaborate a little bit then more about your feelings about the strategic part of the war and you know, how we were not as successful or you felt like there was.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think, so I think our first time there, or at least when I first got there, my initial thoughts were, there is no way this country's like building nuclear weapons. Like I just couldn't see it. It just, given the road conditions, the sewage in the you know, the side of the roads, and the just trash everywhere. And this is just Baghdad, right? This is supposed to be the, you know, my understanding, you know, in the '70s, eighties, it really was like the prime city in the Middle East. Right. And it just had deteriorated so much. And I couldn't see how this country was building nuclear weapons. And I think that was the ultimate premise, right? That they're building,
weapons
of mass destruction, right? You know, chemical weapons, etc. And so I think that's where in my mind is like, I don't know if we should be here or not. And that's, I think, my initial frustration started. And then, so that was about an 8-month assignment. Interesting enough, like, we were there for 3 months. We came back to Tampa at MacDill Air Force Base. That's where SOC sent at. And then I think things started flaring up that summer. So we went back again. I end up coming back, like my assignment's over. I get back to my unit at First Cav, and they're basically, hey, we're going to Iraq. What do you want to do? And I was like, well, my choices were either go to the command, called the Captain's Career Course, or go with the unit. And my rationale, I decided, like, no, I'll go with you guys. And I thought to myself, you know, if I go to the Captain's Career Course, I'm going to get to some unit that I'm not going to know anybody at all. And I'm going to get deployed with these guys. And if I'm going to go to war with someone, I'm going to go with a unit that I grew up in, right? Meaning I was a platoon leader there. I was on staff. So I knew everyone in the battalion. And so that's basically the second time I went.
So what was your rank then, if it wasn't going to be?
I was captain at that time.
Oh, you were a captain. Okay.
Yeah, it was a captain. Yeah. So I was a captain the first time I went to Iraq. So, and I left as a captain, like I say, it's 2 years later. So
nice.
And I would say that was actually the more of the, shall I say, seeing real action, if you will. So I was with the 13th Signal Battalion. We went to, you know, we're in Baghdad, and that actually was just the worst. I was the staff officer, they call it the S1. And so leaving out of Fort Hood, my job is to make sure everyone's ready. We've got 900 soldiers, make sure everyone gets to the right base. Everyone's got their shots. Everyone's got like
babysitter.
Yeah. It's like a checklist of all these things to do. And so that was just, I was a staff officer, just pushing paperwork in combat. And for me, again, I was just like, this is just horrible. I just can't stand this. And then finally, I guess call it luck, if you will, one of the staff officers in 17 Cav, it's like one of the more premier Cav units, they're swapping out. So they swapped me with him. And that's when I was like,
helicopter attack?
We had tanks, Bradleys, Humvees. Our Kiowa Warriors, so the helicopter's got that bulb on top. That was detached to the aviation brigade. So we didn't necessarily have that. And so that's when I was really on the ground, going on patrols every day with the battalion commander, the squadron, they call them the SCO. And so I would actually ride right behind the driver and get the squadron commander on the passenger side. And that was sort of 4 to 5 hours every morning. We'd go on patrol and see a lot of fun stuff.
I mean, were you guys kicking indoors and stuff, or was it just going around in circles?
I like to say it was a drive around and wait to get shot type of thing. So there's a few instances where we came across something, and you know, we came across a carjacking, and you know, we go to this house, and you know, it's just this guy's like shot in the stomach and he's bleeding, but we're like, hey, let's go get the bad guys, right? And we helped him out, don't get me wrong, we helped the Iraqi out. But that was like one instance where we go through these homes, and they had taken off. Like, they didn't stick around. It's not the.
Were you guys working with the citizens at that time, or were you still on alert and like, we're not talking to those guys? We don't know what we're doing.
No, just yet. So at that point, we had already established, okay, who are the mayors of these various like areas? Who are we call them power brokers? Who are the people we need to get contact to establish like stability in these communities? And so we were meeting with people, we had interpreters, we were working with the Iraqi National Guard as well, in terms of getting them trained up. That was always challenging, right? Because it's, I feel like there are some cases you don't know, what side are they on, right? What allegiance do they have, right? And so we never had any problems, luckily.
My friends call it the shit show.
Yeah, it was a shit show. but we knew a lot of the people there. And so that's, there's certain areas we'd go check on and just say, hey, how are things going? And for the most part, our area, our sector was relatively, I would say, pretty violence free for my take. We had a couple incidents. There's always something. We had the, it's called Route Irish, which is connected, you know, Baghdad, the airport to, you know, the Green Zone. Right. And that was like the most trafficked road in Baghdad. And like that summer, it was literally called like the most dangerous road in the world.
Oh, geez.
And so I'm on that road like for 6 hours a day during the summer. And like, geez, like, I don't know. We didn't get hit once, like that, which is surprising in my opinion, but we'd always get calls like, hey, car bomb here, et cetera. So we go secure the area. And so you see some pretty gnarly stuff.
My son, Kyle, he did the 6 years and he did not get deployed.
Oh, okay.
He is like really, really, really having a hard time with his service, you know, like for me, I'm like, bro, you sign your name on the thing. That's good enough. Go get a beer at the, you know, go get a beer at the VFW. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, cool.
You know, whip out your card at Home Depot and get 10% off. And he just won't do it. He's like, yeah, I'm not really a soldier. I didn't really do anything. I go, well, you weren't asked to do anything. You would have, you know, like, you know, can you shed some light on that? I mean, I know you, it was like almost like where you didn't go almost, you know, you might have missed.
Yeah. Well, that's good.
Are you a real soldier? You know, are you a real veteran? You know,
I don't go. You know, I think here's my view on that is that, you know, to your son, right? Like we signed the doc, right? We said, hey, you know what? If we got to go to combat, I'm volunteering to go. Whether you go or not, I don't think that really matters.
Good.
So I think there's not really like a, like, oh, he's a real soldier or he didn't see anything.
Right.
You know, that's time. That's a year away that we could have been gone. Right. And, and I mean, there's very sadly, you know, there are people who were just on base camps that got killed, unfortunately, right, from rockets coming in. So it's not like you were, if you're out there, you're at risk, I'd say. And the fact that you signed the doc, say, hey, I'm going to serve, like you're saying like, hey, I'm willing to go to combat if our country needs us. Right.
Yeah.
And so, but I can understand where he's coming from. I probably would have felt the same too if I had deployed. I'm like, yeah, I didn't really say anything. So yeah, I'm not a. I think that's probably a warrior type ethos thing, I would say.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, I would say, hey, you know what? You signed the paper. You were willing to go. You just didn't get the call up, right? So I've had guys who went 4 or 5 times, right? And that's just, it's just unbelievable. That's years, right? That's 5 years of your life in Iraq or Afghanistan. So pretty crazy.
Yeah. It left a pretty good impression on some guys. You know, I have a really good friend who's probably going to come on the show shortly. If we can get him here, he works at the Pentagon now. He flew helicopters in the first Desert Storm. And he was a guy, he went to Cal Poly Pomona and was in the reserves, you know. I mean, he just all of a sudden started moving up the ranks, and when he came out of when he got done flying overseas, he did medevac stuff, and when he got done doing that, he came back, and then 9/11 happened, and so he was part of the first group that they put together, a task force and commission that they put together to handle what happens whenever all the airplanes are down if we get attacked again like that, because they didn't anybody doing that, you know.
No playbook.
Again, by layman's
term. That makes sense.
So he got in on that part of the ground floor, and he was a guy who worked with a lot of 3 and 4 star generals and was on these committees, and I'd go, dude, I remember where you and your you were, you know, back in the day and shit, you know. Now you're in, you know, at the Pentagon working with these guys, and you're a big part of this. He was a really smart guy, don't get me wrong. He was very, very, very intelligent, high IQ guy. But he said, he goes, Chuck, it's great. He goes, I sit and listen, and I'm in the meetings that I'm in, that I'm allowed to be in, and I'm in, you know, I got a certain amount of clearance that I get to sit in on a lot of that stuff. And every so often somebody will go, what do you think, Mike? and Mike wasn't afraid, and Mike has never been afraid to speak up, you know, and what he thinks. And so he goes, eventually, you know, I made enough of conversation with these guys that they went, fuck, we really appreciate that.
He's a go-to guy.
Yeah.
Well, and then he said to somebody at one point, he goes, why do they fucking care what I say? I'm a freaking nobody, you know. I mean, but he goes, because you're outside of that head.
Exactly.
That in
exactly.
For so long that you give them that perspective of somebody who's smart enough to know, you just don't have the experience and haven't been, you know, haven't been worn torn like they are and tired of the whole process. And it really did well for him. He's now, he still works at the Pentagon. He's a civilian now, which he's a guy from St. Paul that I swear I've got to put you in touch with him.
That'd be great. That'd be great.
Just to have a conversation with him, because he's a cool dude and he would appreciate the whole.
He's finally making some money.
That's good. That's good.
Civilian contractors, baby. That's where it's at.
No doubt, actually. they did very well.
So when you're getting to the end of your tours and starting to think about retiring or stepping out and ending your service, you know, what's going through your head? Where are you at? What are you thinking?
That's a very good question. I'm in Baghdad. I'm looking at probably getting out around May timeframe, 2005, right? And, I knew a couple of things. I knew I didn't have, at least in my mind, I didn't have like the skill set to just go straight into like I don't know, General Electric at the time, or a Target or some corporation, right? I was like, man, I don't know what I'm doing. Like I've never run a business. I've never been a corporation, right? I mean, my first job was in and out for like a year, you know, here on like, here in La Habra, right? So like that was like that literally was my experience in like corporate America, right? So, and so I figured, you know what, let's look at business schools, whatnot. And at the time I was like, you know, I missed every single deadline at this time. And so that was kind of like a, okay, what am I really going to do? And fortunately, Texas Christian University was trying to, TCU, they're really trying to build their MBA program. And you know, I wrote them to say, hey, look, just got back from Iraq. My GMAT's really horrible because I didn't have a chance to really study. But you know, look, I deployed twice as a captain, et cetera, whatnot. And
right.
They were very receptive to, hey, look, get the application in, try to get us in by like in 2 weeks and we'll see what we can do. And got, you know, a letter of acceptance. They said, hey, we're going to make you a grad assistant. You're not going to pay for any of the, you know, the tuition and whatnot. And I was like, okay, wow. Yeah. Where do I sign up? Right. So that was sort of where I was at.
Did you get any grief? Like, I know that most cadets go in 20 years, right? They're going to retire. Yeah, if you go to West Point, you're going to retire. Like, not very many guys are jumping out midstream, right? I mean, is that unusual?
Yeah. So that's a very good question. And I did get some crap, if you will, right? You know, I just remember my battalion commander telling me, he's like, hey, sir, I'm going to turn in my paperwork, et cetera. He just looks me straight in the eyes, like, you know what, Mark, you're never making it in corporate America. And I'm just like, that was just like, you know, this burning fire inside me. And to this day, so I probably still have the chip on my shoulder on that one. But
yeah, I actually recognize that face. I think you made that face to me in 1994.
But it's just like, you know, and so, there is some pushback. I think the battalion commander, the 17 calf, he was fine with it. I think we've gone through so much shit, you know, where it was just like, you know, I get it. I think he probably got it. And so that was probably the only pushback I got overall.
The worst part,
you know, I would say that the time at SOXANT was very, like, for me, very transformational, at least from my experience in terms of what we're told, right? Like CNN wise, you know, because my first flight to Baghdad was Doha, Qatar, to the Jordan airport, or it's not airport, but military base. And you see these CNN headlines saying Jordan is not participating, they're not helping. I'm like, I'm in the Jordan military base on a C-130. Like, this is bullshit. So that kind of, in my mind, it's like, this is very interesting. Like, what gets presented. And like, at the end, I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but it makes you think like, okay, well, what's really happening behind the scenes? And, you know, eventually they revealed that they were helping us out and whatnot, but it just kind of makes you think a little bit more critically to what's actually happening. So,
yeah, the politics always, eventually everybody that I know that went through it eventually went, oh my God, you know, now that I see and understand the politics involved, it all makes sense a lot more. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, they always said that it felt like we were just dumb, you know? Sometimes, you know, like, we weren't fucking doing the right shit, and then they go, no, okay, that's just politics. And once they got that figured out, it was they let that go, you know.
And actually that actually reminds me of, like, you know, this one, and this is actually in one of the books that I think it's Rickens, I think that I'm probably butchering the name, but he talks about, you know, the first civilians that went there to, you know, basically kind of run the country, right? And you know, I'm in the JOC and the JOC at in Doha, Qatar. The colonel was like, hey Mark, I need you to get me all the civilian numbers for these guys who are coming out there. And I get like five phone numbers, right? Maybe three. I'm like, sir, this is all I got. I can't find anything. Like, I don't know how they're communicating. He's like, are you serious? I'm like, sir, I'm telling you, three phone numbers. You know, advanced 10 years later, maybe I read this book and they say the same exact problem, how they went there with no communications, nothing.
Wow.
And they expected to just jump on the army's equipment and that wasn't going to happen. And so that kind of gives you an idea of like how our civilian strategic plan was just completely not well thought out, in my opinion. So, and that's like a really good example, at least that, like, I experienced it, right? And Curl's looking at me like, what the fuck, right? But no, yeah, I think, yeah, so we all hit on those points of just from a strategy level, that it was very frustrating. So.
Yeah. One of the cool things that you talked about on in your resume and stuff was motivating the 55 soldier platoon to win the battalion's team evaluations over 10 other platoons. That sounds like a really neat leadership kind of operation. What's up with that?
Okay, so that's You know what? It takes, you know, you, I don't care in whatever organization you're in, you got to have like a great, you know, right hand gal or woman or man, right? And Sergeant Rodriguez, man, I have thought about Dave for a long time, but him and I were just like, and it was like, talk about like the great duo, right? And we just got this, my platoon had gone through a bad platoon sergeant. So he kind of came on board after, and he just, man, we just glued, right? Just like, you know, you know what I'm talking, you guys coach, you guys know the deal where you get that right-hand person and you just really just vibe, right? And we just had a great platoon. We had great squad leaders at the time, and we were just kicking ass. So we got to do these evaluations. We got to do these missions. How fast you set up? Is it right? Are you setting up the communications right? And we just kicked ass. And we just, you know, I guess there's how many? There's three companies at the time, two platoons. So I think there's another sort of side company. So about eight platoons, right? All 55 soldiers each, and we ended up like winning this battalion evaluation. That was it was a pretty good experience, actually. I think about it. It's been a while that I thought about that, and
that's pretty cool.
It really does come down to like it. In my mind, I've always believed one thing: leading by example. You know, that's I think number one wherever you're at. Lead by example, and I don't care if you're in corporate America, if you're in a high school football, soccer, whatnot. If you're leading by example, people are going to follow you. And if you're doing the right thing as well, right? And I think those are important things. And I always felt that, you know, if I'm going to tell my soldiers that, hey, dig these trenches and maybe I'm not busy, I want to be out there digging with them. I want to make sure that I'm leading from the front. Front of combat patrol, I make sure I'm in the lead vehicle. I'm not in the back somewhere. Okay, hey, if something happens, I'm not going to get hit, right? Like, right? So I'm going to put myself at risk. And I think soldiers, especially when we drove up to Baghdad, that was a long drive from Kuwait to Baghdad. But I was like, hey, I want to be at the front. I'm not gonna be the guy who's like gonna fly in from Kuwait to Baghdad. I mean, we had very few guys who did that, but you know, I wanted to make sure my soldiers like, hey, look, I'm gonna be there with you guys. I'm not gonna be carrying the back and the rear, and let's go do this. So. Yeah.
Was there ever like moments where you kind of really identified that, you know, your athletic background, there was something connected to that? Were there guys that were athletes? Did they have any advantage that you saw, or was it just a mental game?
They were, I think it's a mental game. I think the guys, well, I think there's three armies. Well, there's probably four armies, if you will. When I say that, there's the SOC sent guys that I went with, right? The Navy SEALs, Green Berets. I mean, that's just different level. There's a guy who run 20 miles every morning, and then before coming into like the talk, right, or the jock, and he's like a Navy SEAL guy. He's like, oh yeah, I just ran like 20 miles. I'm like, where? He's like, oh, just around the base, like fence, like perimeter. I'm like, is that boring? Like, what? But that's like, that was their. These guys were just superhuman, right? So I think that's a little bit different. I'll say that right up front. The 1-7 cav guys, you know, we're on tags, Bradleys. I think I think there are some guys who are super athletic, football players, wrestlers, and I think there's a different mindset. Right. And I think going through those experiences, because, you know, I think we all deal with, you know, setbacks, right? When you're a soccer player, football player, whatnot, right? You got injuries, you have a loss, and you got to come back up, and you got to get back up and go back at it again. And I would say that those people, I think there's definitely an edge. Absolutely, like 100%. And you know, some of the things I think about is even to this day, I'm like, you know, there's sometimes we've had some bad days where, you know, our guys got hurt, but 6 a.m, we were back on patrol again. You know, you didn't have time to like process all that. And that was pretty challenging overall, but you look back and you're like, you know what, maybe it was all that stuff, you know, football, getting your ass kicked a couple of times and getting back up and, you know, hey, like, let's go back at it again. So I refer to the warrior ethos a lot, because I do feel like that's very important. And just having that mindset, and that translates into like football, soccer, wrestling, basketball, sure, what have you. Yeah. So softball, whatnot. So. Yeah.
So you went to work for In-N-Out.
that was my first job in high school, right?
and so you went to college back to get your master's.
I got my MBA business MBA, yeah. Yeah, that was then 2 years full time. So
yeah, and lead us down the road to you know, studying the financial part of it and really starting to think about what you wanted to do, and then you had to go out and do it. How did that go?
Oh, that's a good question. I really want to do consulting for some reason. I felt like I would do great at management consulting. You know, one of these bigger type firms, you know, whether it's like, I guess at the time it was like McKinsey or Bain & Co, et cetera. I forget all these names already, but somehow, like, I guess during one of these conferences, I meet someone who's a West Pointer at Goldman Sachs, and I just happened to see his lapel. I'm like, oh, hey, you know, one of West Pointer's friends.
Here we go.
That group, right? So that camaraderie. And so we chatted for a bit. It's like, he's like, hey, I'm a private wealth manager. I basically, you know, I advise high net worth individuals, you know, basically anyone like probably got 5 million or more. Right. And so that was his particular job. And I'm like, yeah. And for me, I just didn't feel like that was like my niche, if you will, being a sales guy, you know, telling people and, you know, whining and dining certain people. And he's like, well, like, you know what, why don't you look at these operational type roles? And so that's where my initial interest in Goldman got started. Went through a variety of, like, it's like 10 interviews, probably like 15 or 20 interviews, I think, total. Just a grueling process. And finally, they fly me to New York, and I think I interviewed through 8 people, like literally 7 in the morning to like 5 p.m., right? And by the last one, I'm just like drained. I just have like no energy. Like, I don't know if I got this job or not. Like, I have no idea. It's just like, it was just grueling, right? And the next day, I get an email like, hey, we're giving you the offer. And I was like, what? Really? Yeah. I was like, and so like everything they teach you at business school is like, you don't want to say yes right away, right? You don't have to, oh yeah, I got it. It's like, okay, well, let me think about it. Like, wait, what? Like, they were just like in shock, right? So like, well, I just want a day to process.
Was Goldman Sachs was at the top of the pyramid as far
correct.
As
correct. Yeah, they're considered the top of the in terms of the investment banking type world. So the next day I did say yes. I'm going to go, and so that's how that happened. And you know, first job was in New York. I was in the prime brokerage operations group, and our job, so I guess let's kind of describe these. I guess we all know what hedge funds are now. So I think over the last 2 weeks, right? So those were our clients. We service the hedge fund clients, meet in the sense that we were like their checkbook, if you will. We were their savings account. I'm going to try to put this layman terms. Their securities were held by us, right? We were their custodian. They did all their sec lending, their margin, et cetera. They did they cleared their trades through us. And so that was our particular role with these hedge funds. Right? Right. My point. Mark, yeah.
Do me a favor, Mark, just give a little bit for our listeners, just give the quickest explanation of hedge funds for them so we can kind of track, you know, this a little bit better.
Oh yeah, absolutely. So a hedge fund, they do get some bad raps, but it's an individual. Let's just say from the start, let's say you got this all-star portfolio manager. He's an awesome trader, and he decides, hey, you know what? I'm leaving Morgan Stanley. I'm going to start my own hedge fund, right? So that's kind of initially how it starts. He'll set up his own business entity, et cetera. He'll get a group of traders, people to kind of run his small business, and he'll reach out to high net worth individuals, institutions, endowments, pensions, and he'll say, hey, look, I make money. Like, I'm great at making money, trades, et cetera. Do you want to invest in my hedge fund? And so that's what a hedge fund is in particular. It's different from a mutual fund. We're kind of used to mutual funds where you have to be an accredited investor or a qualified investor, meaning that you have a certain wealth threshold, right, to invest in these particular entities. The hedge fund could have a variety of strategies, but they're typically known to go long a security, meaning like I'm going to buy Apple, but I'm going to short, say, Google, let's say. So they do short longs and shorts. And so that's what a hedge fund is. And these can get pretty big, right? I worked for a small one down the road. And we'll kind of talk about that. And it was about $100 million that we managed. Someone like 0.72, Steve Cohen, he's probably managing, I'd say, probably $5 to $10 billion.
What's the magic of the hedge fund? Is it quick in and quick out? Is it high risk? What makes these guys pop so much? Why do they hit so much? Why do they like it? Why would I put my money in that? That doesn't sound conservative at all.
So that's you bring up a very interesting point, actually. A very, very interesting point, because over the last, I think, 10 years, hedge funds have not performed, or if, on an aggregate level, they have not beat the S&P 500.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, since 2008, right? Because, you know, you think about 2008, right? We had that huge, financial crisis, and the market, for the most part, has just gone up, right? It's And so they have not been able to beat that particular, those sort of benchmarks, if you will. And so that's Tom, so you bring up a good question in terms of why would you want to do that?
Yeah.
That's a question that the finance industry is dealing with and investors at this time. So that's why should I invest in a hedge fund when you're going to charge me 2% management fee? And then if you make money, you're going to take 20% of that. Or if I just throw in an S&P 500, it might just go
8%.
Yeah, exactly. so that's a conversation that's happening with a lot of, shall I say, pensions, endowments, and whatnot. I think even, you know, look at CalPERS, right? I think they were going to, I think there's CalSTRS, CalPERS, and I don't know which one. And so I'm not going to say which one, but I know one of them was really looking hard at, we're going to reduce the number of managers we allocate to that are hedge funds. Cause like we don't feel like we're getting the value. Right. And so I think maybe pre 2008 hedge funds were the, hey, like you want to make some money. You want to make 30% in 1 year, go to this guy, right? Go to this guy at Ken Griffin at Citadel, right? Like he's going to make you some big money.
Bernie Steve Cohen. Madoff, was he a hedge fund?
Technically he was actually, I think he was. But that's
a whole different story. That's another podcast.
Exactly.
So now you're involved in hedge funds and doing that kind of work. Mm-hmm. Was it fun for you? Or did you dig it? And was it like, it sounds like it's really exciting, you know, being in New York and
a lot of commas and zeros.
The operational side, I would say, is not like the, definitely not the glamorous side. You got your front office, I guess they call it the front office people within prime brokers that are dealing with the hedge funds, right? My team's right in between sort of that group and then making sure all their stuff works, right? Meaning like the money's going the right place, their trades are settling. Like to say, it's sort of like that's where the sausage is being grounded, et cetera. And not it's not exciting, right? It's not that glamorous. I actually liked it just because it was new to me. I liked the stock market finance, whatnot. I had begun investing, if you will, like right out of college, right? I'm talking like $50 a month in a mutual fund, right? Like that was like, mm-hmm. Like my first like investment ever, right? It was literally like $50, like some USAA technology fund, right? And so it just being a math guy, being a computer science guy, I really enjoyed reading about the financial world, what was happening in stock markets, about various companies, how politics and macro events impact the market and whatnot. And so I enjoyed it. I mean, did it for 11 years, right? So,
Did you go into the hedge? Like, did you put your money into the hedge fund, or did you just kind of do your thing after hours? And
so at Goldman, there's very strict rules in terms of where you could put your money. So for the most part, you kind of just put your money in a certain, their 401k, et cetera. You have to disclose any type of accounts that you have outside of that. And you're really restricted on what you can trade. So there's this whole concept of like, oh, these guys know what's going on and they're making moves. Like that's not true. And then I guess this leads into the, you know, I'm there for Goldman for a year at New York and my boss pulls me, hey Mark, would you be interested in this expat assignment at the Bangalore office? Basically they got their prime brokerage operations group in Bangalore.
In India.
And in India, not Indiana. So in India. Yeah, so we literally the next day, I'm like, yeah, sure. Why not? He's like, hey Mark, typically somebody like will spend about 2 weeks thinking about this. I'm like, oh, well, sure. Like, well, I'll just go. Why not? Like, I've never been to India. And so that was, we kind of briefly talked about this before. It was a really, really great experience living abroad, totally different culture, great people. I had an awesome team and just a very great experience overall. And
fantastic food.
Amazing food, right? Just amazing. I love spicy food. It was great. And
okay, Mark, I gotta ask you, Mark, before you get too far ahead, because we're gonna skip over a little part that I want to make sure we cover, because you're a fairly young guy and you're working at Goldman Sachs and living in New York. Did you have fun? I mean, did you leave to go to India because you weren't having any fun, or was
no? I had a girlfriend at the time. She actually worked at Goldman as well.
Our couple.
And I felt bad. In hindsight, I probably should have left, but that's, they had this great opportunity. And I just felt, you know, everyone's like, Mark, if they ask you to go somewhere, you got to go there. Like, you can't say no. Like, these are promotion opportunities within Goldman. Like you say no, it'd be like, you're sort of turning down potential opportunity down the road.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, we tried to make it work when I was in India. It was tough. You're allowed like certain time, you get allotted a certain amount of cash to like fly back, et cetera, a certain time. So I was able to take time off. I go to LA, take a week off, then I fly to New York and work in the New York office and spend time with her, or have, you know, have her visit in LA. We try to make it work, but it's just different time zones. And like, then 2008 happens and we're all stressed. And it's just, it was a tough
time. Did you live in Manhattan? I mean, or do you live in Brooklyn, or where did you live?
I mean, so I lived in Hoboken, which is right. I don't know if you're familiar. Yeah, exactly. So I would just take
the tunnel or the bridge?
Take the tunnel. I'll take the tunnel or take a ferry. I usually take the ferry. It was kind of nice just to kind of just catch up on news while you're on the water, like a 15-minute mm-hmm. ride at that. Hoboken was great. I had a nice apartment, like view of downtown Manhattan. I can't complain at all. So
I just wanted to make sure, man.
Because yeah.
You know, I love New York, and I know what you know. I visited it way too late. You know, I should have been hanging out there in my early 30s.
It gets better for me when I was on the buy side, though. So we'll kind of get to that later. I don't know if that translate where I left Goldman to help start up a hedge fund. So then that changes everything, right? So that's when it's like okay, I'm kind of sick of like Flemings and like all these steak dinners and you're being wined and dined by like a Morgan Stanley, B of A, Goldman Sachs, and that was the fun part.
So, nice, very cool.
Yeah,
so toward the end of your career.
Go ahead.
Yeah, that's true. I don't know if you want to talk about India and whatnot, but I did hedge funds for about, or at least in Houston, I was at a hedge fund for about 5 years. Tudor Pickering Holt, TPH. We helped start their asset management division. So we started like with $100 million. I think when we left, like we were almost about $1 billion. And came back over here in Pasadena. There's a place called First Quadrant, a little quant fund on Lake in Colorado. That I was their director of operations as well, and they were pretty big. They managed about $20 billion. So and AUM. So
tell us about India. Cool.
Yeah,
I loved India. I lived on this place called Lavelle Road, and the guys, I guess the people I worked with, like, Mark, you're on the Rodeo Drive of like Bangalore. You know, and I got this like 3-bedroom, like penthouse, if you will, like on the third top floor, and just me, which is kind of weird, but it was just great though. I loved it. I mean, it was just a great experience. The expats that were there, I was one of the few American expats actually. So apparently, Americans don't like travel abroad, at least from the Goldman office in New York. And so a lot of the expats were from London. So I made a lot of great friends that were, you know, from the UK, a lot of great friends that were on my team, and just people that were, that actually lived, you know, they're from India, et cetera. And just really good time. It was just, it had its little constraints, if you will. I think like Friday, I think they stopped drinking like on Friday, like midnight, I guess. They kind of like closed out the bars. I may want to even say 10 p.m. I can't remember what it was, but you know, we made it work at the end of the day, right? We'd have like various parties on the weekend, and
come back to my pad.
Yeah, no, it really was. It was like, hey, let's go to my place. I got a lot of space, and we would just, it was a great time. It was a really good time.
I mean, you could really stretch a dollar too, right? I mean,
oh, it was.
If you wanted a limo every day, you could probably afford one, right?
It was almost like, in my opinion, it was just in my mind coming from the Army. I'm just like, wait a second, you're going to give me a 20%. Hardship allowance for being in India
when I was, you were in the Iraq sandbox 10 years ago.
I was like, okay, and you're gonna pay my New York salary? I was like, this is crazy. It was just mind-boggling to me. And then actually, and that's where we're gonna kind of go into this later, but it really got me thinking of like, man, there's something just wrong with like our framework and like our, the way we compensate people in society, right? Oh, versus like, and we can kind of, I'm sure we'll touch on that later, but that's when it really started hitting me, like, yeah, this is crazy. Like, I'm sitting behind a computer all day and I'm making this much, but yet 3 years ago I'm out in Baghdad and like, you know, making captain's salary, right? So it really makes you think about how, what we value, I guess, in America and whatnot. So we'll get to that later, I'm sure, at some point.
Sure. I'm surprised you weren't like royalty or something in India. You know, you got like some sort of arranged marriage and, you know, like
chieftain.
I don't mean to sound disrespectful to the Indian culture. I just
no. I met one woman out there who, like, I think we chatted about this before, right? You know, we kept in touch, and she, you know, I actually got promoted, and they wanted me to go to Salt Lake City, and I lasted like 3 months there. But eventually, you know, we kept in touch, and she was in Melbourne. She ends up going to Melbourne, and I'm looking to go on vacation, and
she's an Indian gal.
She's an Indian girl. And so that, you know, I fly to Melbourne, just, hey, she's like, I'll show you around, etc. And we just really hit it off. And just, you know, it was like 2015. You know, I quit my job, sold all my stuff, you know, about to move out there. And I think the last time I went there, she's like, hey, I don't know if I'm ready for this. And I was like, what?
I have no car now.
Yeah, I just quit my job. Like, I'm like, do you realize like what I was like making back then? Like, I was like, this is like, so anyway, that was a kick to the gut, right? Or punch the gut, whatnot. But live and learn. And there's probably numerous stories like that in my life.
I can't believe with your trajectory, like there's this whole, you know, I know that there's like groupies for the military, you know, like they want to marry you, you know, and then there's like you're a hedge fund guy. Like there's a bunch of groupies there that want to marry you.
It's funny you mentioned that because there's, well, when Goldman was at 85 Broad, right. That was like the headquarters building. There's like a bar. I don't even know if it's there anymore because they had moved to a different headquarters now. It was like, it's called Ulysses, right? And after, on a Thursday, Friday night, to your point, like, they're out there, you know?
All the groupies come. Here we go.
No, it's mind-boggling. Like, coming up from Pico Rivera, you know, it's like, whoa, where am I at? A different planet, right? So,
yeah, see, I knew there's New York. There's New York as well. That smiles enough. I mean, we can go into a little bit deeper sometime, but that's what I was talking about. Yeah.
Yeah.
We're going to freeze frame that smile.
It's funny. I'm in no way a financial guy, but I came out of school and I went to work for First Interstate Bank back in the day when First Interstate, number one in California. And I got to work downtown in the 707 building, and we worked with Peter Ubrot for the Olympics and the 84 Olympics and shit like that. I mean, it was just a fun place to be, you know, in that financial world. And I was at the bottom of the totem pole, but it was a neat scene. And I have friends that did the same kind of thing back east, guys that I went to school with in college, and they work on Wall Street, and they just, you know, I mean, it goes from 0 to 60 really fast. Guys are getting burned out at 32, you know, and shit. I'm like, you know, there's a lot going on, but you know, it sounds like a really interesting thing, you know. You can get a chance to make a nice living and have some fun and do that kind of stuff.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
I mean, you could definitely see how people get caught up, right? And just get,
oh, absolutely. Wrecked, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. I think I might have saw like one or two individuals that you think like, wow, they're just going too fast, and slow down there, buddy. So,
I mean, when I was in high school, it was all about the movie The Wall Street, you know, Michael Douglas. Greed is good. I mean, I remember wearing suspenders to one of the dances, the homecoming dance, like, you know, the French Cup. I'm going to drive a Porsche and a Ferrari. And like everybody was like, oh yeah, we got to be stock market guys. In fact, one of my buddies, Jim Toth, he started out his life as a stockbroker. That was
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah.
He's now, he was in Hollywood now, but back then he was, you know.
Yeah, he's one of the top talent agents in Hollywood.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, wow, nice,
He's married to Reese.
That's a good, that seems a very, like, seamless transition, though. Stockbroker Hollywood, you know, right?
Exactly, right? Yeah.
It's a great story. His story, yeah. I mean, whenever we go, when we meet our, when we meet Chuck's buddy, we go have a beer, I'll tell you the story about Jim Todd.
Got it, okay.
Absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, he married Reese Witherspoon. You know who Reese Witherspoon is, right?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
He's in all the magazines.
Yeah, it's a match made in heaven. He was Robert Downey Jr. Was his guy. Yeah. Like,
oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, he
made some Iron Man money.
St. Paul guy's making it all up. Know enough about
it. Nice. So,
before we get too far into that, let's pivot to the GameStop before we go too far.
Yeah, we haven't talked about
it. I do want to hear about the art side. Chuck and I really talk a lot about art and how that can make a person feel better.
Absolutely.
That. But let's hear about let's get the nuts and bolts of this crazy thing, and then we'll finish with, you know, we'll go in that direction if you know.
Okay. So
just pretend like you're on the news right now.
Yeah, so here's what's interesting about GameStop, and I'm actually, I felt somewhat a little bit tied to it in a sense. So, you know, late December or, you know, last year, my brother, I'm in Whittier, living with my brother here in the house we kind of grew up. It's just me and him.
Nice.
And we're having breakfast, lockdown life, you know, I'm like, why live in some place in downtown LA, right? You know, I tell my brother, he's like, hey, why don't you check out this GameStop? They're talking about Wall Street Bets. And so, you know,
your brother an investor as well?
No, he works for SoCal Gas, corporate, but he knows that, like, I let's just say, I guess ever since I left Goldman, I sort of managed my own book, if you will, like my own portfolio, okay, like making my own trades, et cetera. So he tells me, like, at GameStop. And so I take a look, and I think everyone's all familiar what they do, right? They're a retailer that declined, right? Video games, et cetera. I noticed that it has like this high short interest, right? So I think that's probably start there. Like, I don't know if everyone knows what shorting a stock is, right? And that's probably...
I don't.
Yeah, so that's and I think that's where it really comes into play a little bit later, where, and we talk about hedge funds, right? So if I'm Tom, say you buy GameStop, right? And you own 1,000 shares in your Fidelity account, let's just say.
All right.
I'm a hedge fund. Okay. And I'm like, you know what? This GameStop company's garbage. I'm gonna short it, meaning I'm gonna make money if it goes down.
Okay.
And how do I do that, right? So Fidelity's got this, it's called the SEC lending desk. Which you probably have no idea, and a lot of people don't. but if you're long a stock, your shares are probably lent out somewhere. I'll guarantee that.
All right.
So, and there is regulation around this, and we'll kind of go into that a little bit later. But in order for me to short that stock, I need to have a borrow, they call it. So Fidelity will lend those shares, those 1,000 shares to me, and I get like a locate, if you will. So then there's numbers assigned to it and everything. So I'm borrowing your 1,000 shares, and now I basically have sold those shares at, say, $100, right? So 1,000 shares that I sold at 100, I'm shorting. You might have bought it like, who knows, $50, right? Who knows when, right?
Okay.
So I'm short 1,000 shares of GameStop that I bought at $100, and let's just say it drops to 80, okay? I can go into the market, they call cover, and buy those shares at $80. I bought it, but I had already sold them already at 100. So I booked that $20 difference.
Okay.
So 20 times 1,000 would be $20,000 that I gain, right? So I'm basically selling a stock that I've borrowed from you, but I buy it at a future date.
Now,
it sounds a little confusing, right?
No, but why is this function necessary to make our economy go? Like, why even create this, you know?
So there's various arguments for it. The most typical argument is that short sellers add liquidity to the market, meaning that there's people buying and selling, right? Because when I short it, I'm technically selling, so that you're adding more volume.
Okay.
There is the thesis that, or at least they say that short sellers look for companies that might be fraudulent, might be doing something bad, right? And they do the deep work, right? And say, hey, you know what? This company is... Now, there's some corrupt stuff going on here.
Fishy here, huh?
Like Enron, think of Enron, right? And there was probably short sellers that came in and found there was some stuff going on. And so that's what's sort of the argument for that.
But whether or not you believe that. My 401k is the other thing, right? I'm long.
I want
it to go up all the time.
Exactly. And most, I would say, like 90% of Americans have a 401k, Roth IRA, et cetera. You're long, right? Or I don't want to say 90%. I don't know. I think it's 45% of Americans have like stock, I think, right? So to that effect. So you're long, right? So the short sellers.
I don't mean to be simple, but if the thing has been going up since 2008, how much farther can it go? Am I in the wrong position? Should I be waiting for it to fall like these short guys?
No.
It can't just go to infinity, can it? I mean, at some point it's.
You're talking about just the stock market in general?
Yeah.
I think that's a good question. There's going to be corrections, right?
Yeah.
I think
right
I
when
think,
I turn 55.
Yeah. Well, that's where you rebalance, right? They say, right?
62. I'm going to
go some bonds, right? Or go something safer. I think so. You think about humanity, right? So I'll go a little deep here, right?
Please.
There's always going to be population growth, right? Or at least we assume. There's always going to be new businesses. There's going to be, so we have about 300 million Americans right now. I'm not sure what our birth rate is, but maybe in 50 years, there's 330 million, right?
Yeah. Right.
So that's population growth. That's people who need to eat, people who want clothes. And so that's the growth in the stock market.
Okay.
In theory, right? Where you have like, say, Japan, who I think has like almost like a negative birth rate, right? Yeah. So they're, yeah. So it's been, so over the last 20 years, like their market has really been going up as a function of the Japanese central bank. Mm-hmm. They've been buying their stock. Like, I think they own like 80% of the stock in the Nikkei. Wow. And so I don't think a lot of people know that, but that's the reality of Japanese stock market. Wow. And so that's a
dangerous deal, right?
Yeah, it is. And so you think about, well, how's the Japanese economy 100 years going to look, right? They've had the same number of people and they have an aging population. It's weighted towards older people. And so there's not as many young people. How are they going to support that economy with those numbers? So that's actually a very good comparison, because then you should see how, okay, I can see how America continues to grow. Population growth, et cetera, new businesses, people. And that's in theory how the stock market grows.
Okay.
And yeah, that's a good question. That's a very good question, though.
So what did these guys do? So they bought a bunch of shorts.
So you got GameStop, which a lot of people thought, okay, this is going to go in the dumpster. It's going to go bankrupt. It's just, you know, these retail stores. Everyone's playing, you know, everyone's at home playing PlayStation, downloading the games, right? Right.
Yeah, we don't buy them.
Yeah, exactly. You're not buying them. And so you got all these hedge funds that shorted the stock, right? And here's where I think people were wondering, well, how do you short more than the float, right? They say 120% of like the shares were shorted, right?
Okay.
And a lot of people can't wrap their head around that. I'm going to explain this, and I think it's going to make perfect sense once I'm done.
All right, love it. Okay.
So let's just say GameStop has 100 million shares outstanding, right? And a lot of people don't know, maybe they do know, is that the Chewy's founder, I think his name was like Ryan Cohen.
Okay, Chewy.
So we all know Chewy. If you have a dog, cat, etc. He was the founder. I mean, PetSmart's bought him out for like $8 billion, right? So he's done well for himself. So he buys like a 7% stake of GameStop, right? In late last year.
Long.
He's like, hey, I think his vision was like, you know what? I think I could revitalize this company, right? So, you know, he gets 7 million. So he owns, let's just say 7 million. And don't quote me on the numbers, but we're just going to use the example. Yeah. Actually, let's just say he owns 10%.
Right.
So he gets 10%. He's got 10 million shares, right? Out of the 100 million. Yep. So the float is now 90%, right? Meaning the actual, because he's going to hold on to that. You know, he's not selling.
Yeah.
That's not trading.
He's in. And then
exactly. Then you got Michael Burry. I don't know if you've seen the Big Short. I think Christian Bale plays him, right? He's the guy who like kind of, he's got Asperger's, right? And so Michael Burry's actually.
Yeah, I got drunk halfway through that because I couldn't figure it out. I was okay.
So last year he's still managing money. So he kind of surfaces again, which is kind of interesting, right?
That's weird.
And so they're probably gonna have a movie with him again. he takes a stake as well. So let's just say he takes a 5% stake, right? So now we got 10 million, you got 15 million, and you probably got like the executive board probably has another. Let's just say 5 million, right? So now you got 20 million shares that are not traded off. Basically, they're locked up.
They're locked up.
So now the float is now 80 million. They call it like the float. Mm-hmm. You got 80 million shares, but those shares that they have, they're probably lending, their broker is lending those out, right? So the float.
And you're allowed to do that. You're allowed to lend
you can. So I'm most positive you can. So that's where you get more than 100% of the float being shorted. Okay. See, does that sort of make sense now? And that's where, and so add some other corporate, say, let's just say Fidelity has GameStop, right? You could start whittling this down. We're like, oh my God, the float was only 20 million, but yet, you know, 80 million shares were shorted, right? And so that's where, so that's where we have this, they call it a infinity short squeeze. Okay. So now let's get to the Wall Street guy, the Wall Street bet guys, right? The on Reddit, right? So mid-January, well, here's where the story comes in. Geez Louise, this is the worst trade of my life ever. We'll get to that later. But I buy at $22, a good chunk of change. I bought GameStop at $22 because I told everybody, I was like, dude, this is ripe for a short squeeze. I'm like, if this founder gets a board seat or he does something, this thing's going to take off. Right. Like, because I'm very familiar, this is from experience, right?
Right.
And so I go pretty big on it. And then in January, about the mid-January, I can't remember the date, it drops to 17. And so I'm like,
it hurt,
like,
huh?
Oh, yeah, I'm hurt. I'm like, you know what? I got to get out. I can't risk proper risk management. I was, you know, if I had a job or whatnot, I probably would just let it ride, right? I'm like on my own, you know, I'm like, hey, this is my bread and butter. Like, I got to eat. You know, I mean, I say that, but you know what I mean? It's just, yeah. I can't risk that capital. Like, I just can't. And I mean, you can't trade if you lose your capital, right?
Right.
So I get out at $17. But then all the Wall Street stuff started happening. And what really was the catalyst was the Chewy's founder got a board seat. And also, I think maybe something, some other thing where like, hey, you know what? You got a big stake. He demands a board seat. So now you're like, oh, he's going to start changing the company because he's got a board seat.
Right.
And then you got other people on Reddit, whatnot, saying like, hey, GameStop. And so that triggered the short squeeze, meaning all the people who are short, when it goes up to like 20 to 30, they're like, oh my God, like I just lost, you know, like 50%, right? Because yeah. you're when you're short, you can lose an infinite amount of money. People don't get that.
Woo!
Yeah. So if something goes, yeah, if you're short something that's 10 bucks, it goes to 100, you got to pay that $90 difference. So imagine if it goes to 1,000, right? So these guys are getting, it's called a short squeeze because they're getting squeezed, and you got the guys who are, so they call it covering. They're covering their shorts, which means they got to buy. You got the Reddit people, Wall Street Bets. Hey, let's buy this company. Let's drive this stock as high as we can to screw with the hedge funds.
Yeah.
And so it becomes a feedback loop.
Right.
That's what ends up happening where, so it goes to 20 to 30, let's just say. And then you got other guys, oh, 23, I'm going to short this. Oh, it goes to 40. The guys who came in at 30 are like, oh my God, I can't take this. They shorted. You got the Reddit people like, keep buying. Let's drive this thing to 1,000, right? Because that's what was happening. And so that's where within a span of what, 3 or 4 days, it went from 20 to like $400, right?
Jeez.
And so.
Those guys had to pay $380 on those shorts.
If you were able to stomach that, I think yeah, so, yeah. Right? And I think Melvin Capital, right? I think they lost $3 billion. I'm not even sure what their position was. And so that is the infinity short squeeze, right? And then here's where it gets complicated, right? On Thursday, like everyone's like, what's going to happen with GameStop, et cetera. Then you have a majority of these people trading on the Robinhood app, right?
Yeah.
Everyone on Wall Street Bets for the most part. And people, my brother's on, you know, Robinhood, so are his friends. They just all of a sudden say, you can't buy GameStop anymore. Jeez. Like you can only sell it. What? And so I think it was on Thursday, you know, it was at 300 something. Market opens, they just dropped, they made those restrictions, and you're basically taking millions of buyers out of the market, right? You could sell, but you take a pool of buyers, and that's when you saw that drop, right? And people were just furious, right? Because they basically, I mean, for all intents and purposes, from my opinion, that's price manipulation.
Absolutely.
That's where the rage came in, right? Saying, oh, but the hedge funds could still buy. They can still sell, right? You just crushed the little guy, right?
So what's the crash going to look like? I mean, where does that... And again, I know it's all speculation, and don't talk about it. Like the picture where the new intersect, where you don't talk about that. I'm sorry.
No. You bring a very good question.
Fight Club. We don't talk about Fight Club.
Yes. Yeah. So here's what I think is happening. And I've spent countless, this last week, 2 weeks, I would say has been very, just all the volatility in the market. And so like, okay, what's going to happen next? And I think here's my take. I could be wrong. We'll see. We'll see in about 6 weeks, I think, about 6 months. I feel we'll get a good feel for what things are happening. I think with the Biden administration, you know, they want to do another stimulus. They're talking about student debt relief, right? I think there's going to be probably some sort of infrastructure bill to rebuild America, right? Or what needs to happen for that to all happen? You got to print more money, right? So the Fed Reserve, again, here we go again. Fed Reserve got to print more money. That debases your dollar. So the dollar that you bought a beer with today, maybe in 8 months, you might need $3, right?
Right.
And so I was, you know, having this conversation with my dad. I was like, Dad, you know what? I know you got your money in like primarily pretty safe investments, but I really think you got to start thinking about like gold, silver type of assets, even Bitcoin, real estate, right? Because when you have inflation, all those assets go up. I think even the stock market might go up. But here's where the problem happens, at least, and I don't know how this is going to play out. Our salaries are going to stay the same.
Oh, yeah.
And so I think the average American is going to wake up one day and be like, wait a second, that carton of, you know, milk, eggs, etc. is now $20 when yesterday I paid $10.
Right.
And I think that
like Germany when, after World War One.
Exactly. So when does that happen? I don't know. It could be this year. It could be 2023. But I think we're kind of close to that because we are, and you see the frustration. So I think we're close. That's why I think that all these little things that are happening are a symptom of some deep frustration with the entire framework of our society.
Well, let me give you my side.
There are some people that are very clear on the fact that you know, it's going to take the stars lining up and the planets, you know, getting in order for us to get come out of this at all. You know, I mean, there's people that have said that clearly.
And so, correct. And I think, and I think what, and that's, it's that's, yeah, you're right. I think, and I think what ends up happening, at least here's what I think should happen. Right. So, all right. There's got to be, someone mentioned the Great Reset, right? Or reset.
Yeah.
There really needs to be an elimination of just like debt, almost like worldwide. And how, I don't know how that happens. That's the question, right? Because you think about, you know, someone's student loan or student debt is packaged as some like bond somewhere and like CalSTRS owns it or CalPERS owns it, right?
Right.
So it's this crazy sort of everything's interconnected. And so how does this work? How does this play out? I don't know. But there needs to be sort of like this, like, I think the end road is all debt is like eliminated at some point. I think there's been people like, I think Bernie Sanders was someone who was like, hey, this is what I want to do. You know, this and that. And to be fair, let's be honest. Trump kind of ran on that platform as well, in my opinion.
True.
But I don't think
redistribution of wealth.
But the tax plan ended up being the biggest like corporate tax cut to the wealthy.
Right.
And so, I mean, let's be.
It didn't feel good when I heard it like that, you know.
No, but that's what it was, and I'm not going to say who bad or good because we could go down this crazy rabbit hole. But the reality was, like, the tax plan just did not help the little guy, even though he ran on that platform. And so that's where I think, hopefully, maybe with I think Bernie Sanders did get like a
Bernie's appropriation
on the budget. So. Perhaps we'll see this. You know, they're already talking about debt relief, and so I think those are a start.
Yeah,
so,
Elizabeth Warren's talking about those student loans, man. I'm like, yes.
Yeah, I know. So, but I think this is a start, and I think hopefully, with us Democrats having the Senate and you know the House and the White House, maybe there could be some traction there, and then finally we can move forward, right? And then get people to where they should be, in my opinion.
Yeah,
well, we missed lessons from 2008.
I think one of your questions around the GameStop was, you know, is this good or bad, right?
Like, right.
I think it's good in the sense that people are talking about the stock market. People are getting smart about it.
They now
understand, like, oh, wait,
grassroots.
Yeah, no, like, wait, Robinhood was selling my debt, like my order flow to Citadel, and then Citadel would trade ahead of me using their algos. No oh, way. Wait a second. Yeah. So
that's my money.
Yeah, exactly. Right. And so you start kind of peeling back the onion. You're like, oh, wait a second. Like now you kind of know what's going on. And the funny thing is like, I always joke that it's rigged, but in some ways I'm not joking. It is rigged. And I go into very examples, but I was telling people last year, I was like, it's so rigged. I'm like, I've never seen more fraudulent activity like in the stock market last year than this year, you know? And so everyone's looking at me like, Mark, what are you talking about? Like, but then everybody saw GameStop. Everyone got hit with the Robinhood. So I think that was like the big awakening, if you will, right? Like,
the
wow.
The problem is for a guy like me is I don't understand those things. I didn't do my due diligence as a young man, you know? And all I see is Amazon made more money during COVID and it feels like a freaking dick. You know, that makes me
yeah.
an asshole. You know, like,
yeah.
back some of that loot. You know, we're all buying Amazon, you know? Like, and that's really faulty. Being emotional about it isn't going to fucking help, you know? So these stories are interesting. It's almost like a viral story where I called you, like, you know, me and Chuck were talking about this. And I'm like, gee, Chuck, I really don't know, but I know a guy.
You know, you're funny. You got my, I think you sent me something and I was like, I'm like, oh man, it's like trading hours. I just can't even like answer this right now.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
But I did see it pop up and I was in my mind. Like, yeah, I just can't, like, I'm watching all these ticks, you know, and I'm in the trenches. So.
Going crazy.
Well, it definitely is good to hear your take on it and get your perspective on it because it helps us understand a lot more about, you know, again, just talking about it. I mean, it's
it's fascinating to me. And I just, you know, I know that there's times when I think it's all going to be okay. And I think that everybody is lived off of, well, it's going to be okay. I'm going to make it through. And everybody just hangs on just long enough for it to be okay. And that's why we haven't changed it, you know, redistributing wealth.
That's a good point.
Because people keep making it through, you know, and so
revolution.
It's an interesting subject to talk about, and I appreciate it shedding some light on it.
Someone's camera went off. Someone asked, like, what was the bad part of it? I think the bad part is they're going to bring in the wrong people to testify in front of Congress, I think. I think Maxine Waters already is saying, like, I want to talk to the deep effing value guy, right, who made, like, he started with $50,000, made $45 million. I want to talk to the Robin Hood. I'm like, where's the Citadel people? I wouldn't sweat
those guys at all. I would give them the Medal of Freedom.
Exactly. Like, where's the Citadel guy? Where's Ken Griffin? Where's, like, Steve Cohen on this, like, on the short side, etc.? Like, those people need to be up there testifying as well. And so I think, again, who gets blamed for this? And but I don't know why.
The guys didn't do anything illegal.
Oh, in my opinion, absolutely not. Absolutely not. No.
They're just citizens. But I think,
and CNBC, like, you know, some, that's kind of comedy network, if you will, in my opinion. But they're trying to blame, like, the retail investors. Like, well, they shouldn't be doing this, etc. I'm like, you're just, in my opinion, upset that they were on the other side of the trade. They were killing it and making money. Yeah. Where the big institution was getting smoked. Yeah. So exactly.
I feel like when they explained my mutual fund to me, I was like, oh, you mean we're all going to put our money together and we're all going to invest so we don't lose big and we don't, you know, oh, protection in numbers. Okay, cool. I just didn't, you know, I didn't, so aggressive, you know, Robinhood, the thing was so aggressive. They couldn't handle it.
Oh yeah, that's just like single name stocks, YOLO options, as they call them, right? It was like, I don't know if you guys heard that, where you're buying deep out of the money, and that's actually another aspect of the story that I didn't even get into, is like this gamma squeeze, right? And that's on options, and that's gonna go off another.
Yeah, trail, let's do another 15 minutes. Yeah.
But yeah, but that's another thing that also played a part in this short squeeze, like going up. So very interesting. Oh, and I did actually, and I do hold like AMC, like I. I mean, look, at the end of the day, I am going to look for opportunity. And on Tuesday, I'm like, you know what? Let me check the heavily shorted list. And I see AMC on there, number three. So I get it like at $4, you know? Yeah. So like, it's like, that's an opportunity in my opinion. Right. So,
is that what you're going to be doing, Mark? Is just staying home and trading, or are you going to try to get back out there?
That's a good question. And I think, here's actually interesting. So the photography thing, I decided to just take a break from that. Like, even though
that's how you and I reconnected was photography. I saw your stuff and I was like, oh shit.
The BLM, right?
BLM and the Burning Man and some of the ladies you had taking pictures of. I was like, whoa. I mean, they were just gorgeous.
Yeah,
it was lovely.
Yeah. So, the classes helped and whatnot. And so I started mixing music. I really love music at the end of the day. And so having gone to Burning Man and, you know, seen all these like DJs play, and I was like, you know what? Like, I've always wanted to mix music. And so I have some friends who mix music, and I started doing, I actually have some sets, techno house sets on like SoundCloud, just for the hell of it.
Nice.
And so I decided, like, I guess this early January, I was like, you know what? I have some projects that I'm working on. I was like, I'm doing too much. Like, I'm trying to do photography. I'm trying to do like some art stuff, some digital art, music mixing. I'm like, I'm going to get away from the photography, chill on the digital art, because my brother was like killing it there, just on as a side thing. I'm like, let's just focus on mixing music, and then maybe by May we could like produce maybe a few techno songs and whatnot. So that's, I think, what I want. I'm going to kind of get focused on this recent market volatility. In my opinion, just, it was an opportunity, and I having done it in a while, like I really wanted to just, I was telling everyone, I was like, nope, I'm done with stocks. I'm just going to buy this in January. I'm going to long hold, etc. But I don't know. It's just one of those things where like it just draws you back in, right? And
so I was gonna send you my $50, my first investment.
Here, let's go. Let's turn to $500. So, but I mean, it is. Here's why I like the stock market, and I was telling people, it's not really even like the money. Sometimes it's really like, I'm looking at politics. I'm looking at geopolitical events. I'm looking at all these things. I'm like, okay, what's gonna happen next? What's my trade? And then because you're competing against like the best guys in the world, right? Like some of the smartest guys. And when your trade works out, your thesis works out, it's like, hell yeah. Like, you know, like I won. Like, it's like, you know, it's like scored a touchdown, right? In my opinion. Yeah. And that's so that's why I really enjoy the, like a chess game, right? Like checkmate, right? Like, okay, I just won. And that was my trade thesis. And I'm banking it right now. And like I said, banking in the sense of like, I'm going to get out of this trade and let's look for another opportunity. And so it's that sort of like the mind exercise or the mental exercise you go to kind of get through that sort of investment thesis and make it work. So that's really, where I find enjoyable.
I really like how you don't let the, you know, that the lifestyle of the stocks and the Wall Street really, you didn't get caught in that because here you are essentially unemployed for 2 years and you seem fine because your lifestyle is.
I say simple.
Yeah, keep it simple, man.
Yeah.
But if you were Garden Gecko, you couldn't survive. You know, honestly.
I'd got to buy another Lamborghini or something. Right? It's like why? It makes no sense.
You got the red one and a black one.
Yeah, exactly. Like, in my mind, like, and that's where I get sort of like, you know, give back. Like, there's so many people, so many organizations that could use that capital. And that's where I feel like, I think one of your questions, like, you know, at the end of the day, I'd rather be known as someone who has a philanthropist as opposed to someone who went to Iraq,
right,
a war vet. Like that's really what I would love to be known, like remembered as. And so I think having, to your point though, like what's next, I do really want to focus on like nonprofit type issues, social issues. Well, I should say nonprofits and social issues. And so that's, I think over the last 2 years, I've sort of focused on. I went to like Northern Iraq, like in late 2019 with a bunch of investors, and we met refugees that were starting companies in Iraq. And so I end up investing in a company called Chatterbox, I didn't meet them through at that trip, but she's in London, and there's this, it's called impact investing. I don't know if a lot of people know about impact investing, where you're making investments in companies and people and that are looking to create companies that make the world a better place.
Yeah.
And so there's a conference called SOCAP up in San Francisco that I went to in 2019. And it's sort of like private equity people, venture capitalist people meeting with entrepreneurs that are really looking to change the world for the better. And I happened to meet her there and, you know, like, hey, like, I really like what you're doing. Her mom was a refugee from Afghanistan, and she has a company where if you're a refugee in say Syria and you know, I guess Farsi or what have you, and you got internet connection, she basically has a language learning platform where say you want to learn Farsi, you're going to be talking to someone who's might be in another country where they can't get a job because they're a refugee. And so she provides that opportunity for them to work through teaching people. Right. I mean, that's amazing. Like that's, and so I'm an investor in that company, and I really felt like, wow, this person really is trying to make a better place with like refugees, et cetera. Like, here's my money, you know? So, so that's sort of the things I'm like looking into. And I think there's a lot of people out there who really do want to make the world a better place. And it's good stuff. Yeah, so that's good stuff. So,
well, you came to the right place because that's kind of the mission statement of our podcast. You know, we're guys, you know, the stimulation to be able to do things like that and share the happiness and share the wealth and
and
do those things. I mean, that changes the world, you know, one cool conversation at a time, you know, and there's, it's neat to hear. And again, to see the smile on your face when you talk about that, because that's part of it. I mean, people who have the means that don't have that in their lives, I think it's a tough existence. You know, we were talking the other day about, you know, you're just pissed off because you don't have your second Lamborghini and you're freaking tired of the first one, you know, but if you have something, you know, that if you have something that is again, sustainable like that in your life, you know, it just balances out things and you can hopefully you can enjoy the rest of that without the, you know, the money being this overwhelming.
Sounds like a mix of music. I'll be happy. So
that's cool. No, but
with your track record,
We can use a theme song, man. We got a couple of intro deals. So if you want to kick us down.
Yeah, I'm not even joking, Mark.
we'll see what I can do. Is it hip hop, techno, house? Is it probably like
whatever specialties?
Yeah, we go all over the place, man.
I mean, and that's our deal is, you know, we'll, if you want, we can put your SoundCloud thing on our card and somebody can hit that. Like, what's this Mark guy? You know, I don't know.
Yeah. Oh yeah, we chat about it. I mean, at the end of the day, I really, and you had one of those questions that if I had Bezos' money, right, like what would I do with it? And here's what another sort of fundamental issue with our country is: why do teachers got to pay for their own supplies? Like, we need to like reform our education system. Yeah. Like, my sister's a teacher. I'm like, if we're the greatest country in the world, our teachers should not be buying, you know, pens, pencils, etc. for their classrooms. If I had that money, exactly. If I had that type of money, I would say, you know what? We're going to make sure every student has the same opportunity, same environment, same sort of resources that like the kid in Beverly Hills has, right? Yeah. And think about what that would do for our country in terms of just innovation, new companies, like 100% of the population really like, hey, we're smart. We're doing all these cool things. Right. Like, you wouldn't have to pay for all the other stuff we're paying for, like social welfare, et cetera. Right. Like, you have an educated population that is doing amazing things. And I feel like that's where I would allocate like that money to, like, hey, let's change our education system, STEMs type stuff. And then I know STEM's like the big thing, but also I think, there's art, literature, et cetera. Like, those are important as well. Like,
I think it's difficult to eke out a, sort of a middle America, a middle class. We're not really preparing kids for the middle class. Maybe they can go get a job at McDonald's, or maybe they can go in the military, or maybe they're going to go to Harvard. But that 80% of the kids, when they walk out of school, you're like, well, yeah, I guess I can read and I can do a little algebra, but we don't have auto shop no more. We don't have wood shop.
Yeah,
we don't
have that's a good point, yeah.
We don't, where those guys are making money.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
And when I started out in education, it was 100% you must go to college. And now 15 years later, I'm like, well, maybe you don't have to go to college and make a hell of a good living and take care of your family and, these kind of things,
Yeah, you're it's a very good point. And also I could go into the whole college cost thing, how they say inflation hasn't risen, but like, whoa, have you seen the college expenses? It's like 30x what the inflation rate is. And so that's
just my buddy's daughter was daughter was going to UCLA and from 1 year to the next year they raised the tuition 25%. And there was riots. They had the riots and they were breaking the glass.
That's crazy. It's mind-boggling in my opinion. So there's that would be the area I would say, like, let's get this fixed. Because you fix that, I think you really do a lot of like adding value.
That's the long game, though, Mark.
Yeah, yeah.
Those results for 20. Yeah.
We're not the first ones to think about that. And why haven't we gotten it done? Because there's this gravitational pull between the right and the left. And the fear of entitlement and those things, and there's a legitimate roadblock to all that stuff because we just can't pull the trigger,
correct,
and dump that money in, because if it's not well thought out and well planned, it'll fail just like a lot of social programs fail. The oversight isn't good enough, and the oversight isn't sufficient enough to be able to manage it. And it's this ridiculous cycle
of
non-doing, not getting shit done. I was really encouraged when the JCs, in the area started to lower their tuition almost down to nothing. And if you lived in the city, you went there, you paid almost pennies on the dollar. There was this movement of a few years ago to do some of that stuff, and it just kind of
it feels interesting. Wow,
never made it to the next level.
I mean, when I went to JC, it was $5 a unit, up to 10 units. So the maximum pay was $50.
Wow.
And you just went to JC. How much does JC cost? $3,000.
Oh yeah, yeah.
I mean, like six.
It was like something like that. So, yeah.
This is JC, Chuck. JC, $60,000.
Yeah, it's crazy.
I don't know where you want to go, Chuck. Do you want to just Later on, or just kind of stop now?
You could probably do a part two, to be honest.
I think what would be really cool is to get together your artwork, your pictures, and put them together so that we can talk about the places you've been, the things you've done. That the travel part of things. Like I said, that's a real interesting part to me. You know, that duality of your nature, and I think I'd like to hear more about the spiritual part of that whole thing.
Go deep into that.
The soldier and the warrior.
that's the beauty of it. That's what makes it so exciting to have you on, because you have to have that. You know,
I truly appreciate you guys inviting me.
I'd like to know more, and I think we definitely need to take some time to, get squared away with my camera and shit.
Well, let me do the speed round with you, and then that'll be the end for today. And then, I can envision a lot of things. I can envision the next weird thing that happened, we bring you on, and the next weird thing, and then maybe in the summertime, we talk about Burning Man and freaking
hopefully have this
walking the earth like Cain, and Buddhism and everything, and Hindu and everything else. I really, really appreciate you talking about these things. It's super selfish.
This is interesting.
I told Chuck, I watched Trading Places this week because somebody said Trading Places was the same shit that happened, like with shorts and all that.
Yeah.
I was just laughing. I keep
I like The Big Short. The Big Short does a good job.
All right. So I got a I don't know if you're a millennial or not. Are you a millennial?
No, was it Gen X, something like that?
Okay, so you're still with me. So let's do the manly version here. Are you ready?
Oh, great. Yeah, sure.
So I'm going to give you two things, and you just pick one. And it's an or thing. And we'll go, first thing that pops in your brain.
Got it.
All right, Elvis or Jerry Lee Lewis?
Jerry Lee Lewis.
God bless you. Beatles or Stones?
Beatles.
Chuck D or L Cool J?
Chuck D, for sure. Fight the power.
God bless you. You're my kind of guy. Ford or Chevy?
Ford.
Coke or Pepsi?
Coke.
Whiskey or tequila?
Whiskey.
Android or iOS?
iOS.
Baseball or football?
Football.
Blonde or brunette?
Blonde.
J-Lo or Selma?
J-Lo.
Not too many blonde chicks over in India. I don't know.
No, but there's Batman a lot or of suit worn.
Sorry, what was that one?
Batman or Superman?
Batman.
World War II or Vietnam?
World War II.
Vin Scully or Chick Hearn?
Oh, a Chick Hearn all the way.
Lakers.
Lakers. Come on. Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
I gotta know one more thing. I gotta know what was your favorite restaurant in New York?
Oh, geez, there's this little it was called Al Tapas, I think. It was like this little I don't think it exists anymore. It was in the West Village. It was just like a little Portuguese tapas place, and it's gone now, unfortunately. So that was my favorite spot. It's as you know, in New York, it's the little hole in the wall places that are the best, right? Yep. So
thank you so much for your time, and we did a great job. It was awesome.
No, that was fun. Chuck, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Tom, thanks. Thank you very much as well. That was awesome. That was fun.
All right, guys. Take care.
The best thing is